Buddy?
Oh.
Thank you all for coming, all my residents, and also people from the community who are coming to support this wonderful concert, which is partly sponsored by the Illinois Arts Council. This is a very special piece that a group of songs that will be done at the back end of the recital called Sac Prairie People. We have the composer, Ronald William Hill, with us, and it's being sung today by Audrey Johnson and William Powers. And Audrey contacted me many, many months ago. I lost track, really a long time ago, and she spearheaded this to have this concert done here and to make a recording, and how wonderful that we get to hear this. So let's give a warm welcome to all our performers tonight. And here is the composer, Ronald William Hill, to tell you a little bit about the performance.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, all of you, for wending your way here and finding this place. It's not necessarily the easiest place to find, I think, but you did really well, so congratulate yourself on that. I will also say just thank you for being here, because it's a very special night for me. This night represents, I don't know, I haven't counted the years, but it's decades. Decades of work, of composing, from the very beginnings of when there was some glimmer of, oh my gosh, maybe I could do this, to, well, why don't we get it down on paper, or somebody down on paper, or then, God forbid, that I should play it in front of anybody, or introduce it to somebody, to get through that, and so forth. And it was quite a process over the years. So this is a program of about 95% me. I'm playing, as I told my wife, I said I had this prepared to say that I'm sorry, I regret to tell you that Long Long will not be here, so I will have to be your pianist tonight. Anyway,
that was
a funny one. So. But anyway, it does mean a lot to me that you're here to share this experience with me, because it's like something you can dream about, but you just don't know. And when you're getting close to 65, you start to wonder, well, is it really going to happen? And then things started to really happen with the help of my friends. And so tonight, you'll share with me this experience. The first half will have some of my standalone vocal pieces and my some of my piano compositions. They're of all different styles and so forth, and I'll tell you a little bit about it, perhaps. Also, then in the second half, we'll do the Sac Prairie People, which is for me, it's like my favorite work and the love of labor, which I've just had a blast composing over the years, and it's been many years. It spans many decades. So to have these wonderful singers here, Audrey Johnson, who has spearheaded the whole idea. She was the one that came up with this idea for a grant and for the concerts and all, and it just started to bloom, and now it's a reality. And Mr. William Powers, who was a connection of hers that she introduced me to not too long ago, and it's been a wonderful, wonderful experience. So to know him and to have him sing my songs, it's like amazing. So anyway, I hope you will enjoy tonight. I hope you will feel good about what you hear. I hope it will move you to various emotions. It's okay. I like that. And so we'll get started. All right, our first piece tonight is with Ms. Audrey Johnson, and it's called Red Dress by the composer. The poet is Russell Salomon, a modern composer, who describes the love of his life in various flowery terms and kind of fuses the various senses together, art and color, especially color, and writing, and voices, and so forth. It's quite an interesting poem. So we'll start with that, introducing Miss Putter Johnson. The piano only, and the first numbers here are all waltzes. I love waltzes. I don't know what it is. You know, a lot of people love waltzes, but I really do love the waltz, and I love the waltzes of Richard Rodgers and from his musicals, and I love the waltzes of Stephen Sondheim and Little Night Music, and I love all. They're just amazing, And I loved to dance it even. In college, that was my favorite in the dance class. So it really got me going on waltzes. The first waltz here is a waltz I did for a foreign exchange student when I was in high school. And I wrote it for her. So I guess I was a junior in high school or something like that. Senior in high school. The second one, The Empty Ballroom, kind of tell just a little interesting story. It came to me very, very fast when Karen and I had been living in Skokie and we were in a basement apartment with two little windows on the north, and we felt like, you know, little whatever, underground, right? And we decided we were going to get our own place, and we visited a place in Wilmette, suggested by our boss at the time. And it had light, it had windows, it had moving air and sunshine. It was like, wow, this is wonderful. But for whatever reason, the reason I'm telling you that is because when I went home to the little apartment in Skokie, all of a sudden this melody just sort of came out of my fingers, and the piece was written very, very fast. It was sort of freaky that way. It even had its own name, it came with it. I felt like, in a way, it was dictated somewhere, somehow. You know, one of those strange experiences. And then the third one is it's a ragtime waltz, and the ragtime waltz is was written for, it's actually dedicated to my college roommate at the time. His name is Jeffrey Lindbergh, who some of you might know of as the artistic director of the Chicago Jazz Orchestra. He's also he's also a professor of music and directs the orchestra at Wooster College in Ohio. So, and Jeff has contributed a lot to the musical world and the number of charts that he's transcribed. It's amazing, the man is amazingly talented. But this was called Boss with the Hot Sauce. It's a phrase that he had. I don't know where that comes from, but it it basically means like, really good, you know? Got that pizzazz, extra pizzazz, you know? Okay, so those are the three waltzes I'm gonna perform. And whatever, you can clap in between, it doesn't matter. You will.
Let it rip, Ron. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I've never played those three together at the same time before, so it was new territory for me to do all three together. Let's see. All right. Now to something completely different.
Can you hear me? There we go. All right. The next piece is a vocal piece, once again, with Audrey. And the piece is by a poem, another modern American American poet. Came from a wonderful book called Golden Horses. And it's called The Lark Ascending. Now, if some of you have probably heard you think of the Ralph Vaughan Williams orchestral piece, The Lark Ascending, which is based on an epic poem called The Lark Ascending. This is not that. This is a different poem. Beautiful. It's a wonderful poem. And it's also, it's in sonnet form, I believe. It struck me when I read it, I go, this is actually in sonnet form. but it's a very philosophical, kind of an Eastern philosophy. Earth, birth and death, and how some things, going up at the same time, other things are going down. And but it's, anyway, it works its way to a beautiful message. And I've tried to make the music reflect this whole atmosphere of the poem. All right, so we will have The Lark Ascending. And I want to say one thing here. By the way, this whole program, actually, this Sac Prairie and The Lark Ascending, not Red Dress, but The Lark Ascending, are all Chicago premieres. So you're in on Chicago premiere.
Yeah.
Made an accompaniment that was really difficult to play so other people could do it.
Seeds to a flight, we
Okay, so now I call this a piano potpourri. This is more like easy listening music, right? This is more in the popular, smooth jazz, that sort of thing. I have Easy, which I wrote when I was maybe 23 or something like that. After I discovered the music of Gershwin, I really love Gershwin, I still love Gershwin. Probably you do too, right? And it's kind of, you know, patterned after something that Gershwin might do. Cool Relief was a piece that I wrote about the same time, and the reason it's called Cool Relief is because it was written during a heat wave. It was really annoyingly hot, and I lived in a house that had no air conditioning, and while I was practicing, I had a concert coming up, a recital, and while I was practicing, the sweat would drip into my ears, and I got an ear infection. I remember that because so Cool Relief is Cool Relief. Maybe too much information, huh? Okay. All right, and Goodbye Sergio is the last one. I won't even go into the title. It's just is what it is, and it's my most recent piece, and it's kind of patterned after, you know, those great movie themes from the 50s and the 60s, you know, like Lawrence of Arabia and Dr. Zhivago and all those wonderful movies during that time has that kind of a flavor to it. And then the last one is called Karen's Song, which we don't know who that would be associated with at all, but it was written because one night in my apartment we were watching, I was at a teeny apartment in Skokie, like I said, and Karen would go to bed before I did, and I would turn on the TV, and I'd watch something, and one night she got tired of it. She just said, why don't you write a song instead of watching this stupid TV? So the next morning, I had a song for her. It's called Karen's Song.
Thank you.
Goodbye, Sergio.
Thank you.
Right. Now we are six. That's the book, the famous A.A. Milne book, Now We Are Six. And I wrote two pieces from Now We Are Six. So it's okay. Let's be six. Let's have the viewpoint of a six-year-old and really enjoy these, okay? All right. Once again, Miss Audrey Johnston.
Red head of tears.
Thank you. Stand up. Have a stretch. Whatever you need to do for 10 minutes or so.
I don't know why we're doing Mitch Lee's music on this program that belongs to Ron Hill, but he said it was one of his favorite songs.
Yeah.
The dream, the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave cannot go, to right the unrightful wrong, chased from afar, to strive when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know that I'll always be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world would be better for this, that one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach, to pray and to preach, to reach out and see, and be worthy to be, and to touch the unreachable.
Like this, we don't hear every day.
Nope.
All right. So now we're in Sac Prairie People. Sac Prairie, just so you know, this is based on the poems of August Derleth. And August Derleth was Wisconsin's most prolific authors. And he lived his whole life in the area of Sauk City, Wisconsin, if you know where that is, on the Wisconsin River. And he wrote about the people there. He always lived in his home area. He insisted on it. He just felt like part of that whole world. And he created this imaginary place called Sac Prairie, because there's Sauk City, if you look on the map, Sauk City, and then there's Prairie du Sac, right? The Sac being the Indian tribe. And so these two cities, two little villages, you know, were part of the whole scene of his, the whole texture of what he wrote about and so forth. He was very non-politically correct. He wrote about the people in the area. He sometimes changed the names to protect the guilty. he didn't mince words. And so I've tried to create music that also is like that as well. The set contains six pieces, like portraits, right? There's something that could be like epitaphs almost. They're just short little biographies about some particular aspect of their life that he found interesting. And then I call them bookmarks, the first piece and the last piece. The first piece is it's called Snowy Night, and it's just sort of about, you know, the wonders of nature and the beauty of silence and snow and so forth. And the final piece is a little bit of a wrap-up, a little moralistic lesson sort of thing at the end of it. The pieces, I would prefer that you don't applaud in between or after these particular pieces. I usually don't have a problem with that, but for this performance, it'd be that'd be okay. The next to the last one called Rainer, you probably won't be able to hold the applause back though, so please feel free to. And then we'll have a little encore piece at the end of the book of poems by Robert Frost. I'm going to read the poem before each one, just so you get an idea of what it is. Snowy night, hushes in the stubbled corn along the fence line, comes windless down on pasture's edge, the snow. In the lit town, the fine flakes sifting down make the streetlights show as flowers, chrysanthemums. Snow lies thickening white on boles, boles are tree trunks, on fence posts and under lamplight bright as day. The solitary walker on his lonely round, hearing whispered, wordless voices all around, would not think anything so animate, so white, could come out of so dark a world as night. Loney reads the catalogs. Grandpa Loney, come February, seats himself where he can tarry lazily in lingering sun and read seat catalogs. A month yet ere he can hear the frogs in choir singing, he treasures all these paper books. He sits all afternoon and looks, peers at yellow corn and red tomatoes, and estimates this year's yield of potatoes. He looks at calendulas and marigold and never thinks he may someday be old for planting things. Grandpa Loney's roomy eyes tell him many lines are sales talk lies, and he boasts, why, back in 71, I had a gourd beat this one hollow. Done it in that summer, no rain, and I bet I could again. Winter that brings the snow, the cold, the treachery to all the old. Brings through the catalogs. The old man knows the name of every rose. He knows that nothing ever is as bright as paper looks, and yet takes his delight believing what he reads, if he can hurry winter on. Sitting in the sun with catalogs, who is it dares to say he does not already hear robins, turtles, frogs?
Grandpaloni, come February, seats himself where he can tarry lazily in lingering song, and reads seed catalogs. A month yet ere he can hear the frogs in choir singing. He treasures all these paper books. He sits on afternoon and looks. Peers at yellow corn and red tomatoes, estimates this year's yield of potatoes. He looks at calendulas and marigold and never thinks he may someday. Planting things. But back in 71, I had a gourd beat this one hollow. Did it in that year, no rain, and I bet I could again.
Sunlight pools in his hot brown eyes where he drowses on the hill where he lies to watch the summer going by. 14. He has no cares. He lies with sun warm in his eyes, gazes on the hawk that floats upon the blue above. He dreams of fish and boats. 14. He disdains love, no heartache. He knows joy. 14. 5 feet of boy, he lies in summer sun, watching summer pass like a bull snake in the grass. 14.
Roses on the hill.
Lily Manzer, safe in her rind of life, shorn of her bloom, poor Lily sat at the window of her room, day and night, lost in the jungle of her mind. Delicate, frail, the happy child she was had grown by priestly wickedness into this pale, weak-minded woman kept alone. She lived in her dark, narrow room until she took a narrower, more dark. In the weft and loom of life, she was early broken by all she trusted, all her love unspoken, all her life held down, all her dreams alone. She is no lonelier beneath her stone.
How horrible. And what if you hear about that?
Thank you.
ants and bogs. Lifelong, he thought first of hogs, cattle, sheep, but failed to think that cutting trees made less for them to drink in pond and brook. Ants and bogs cared for his creatures and his house, killed wild things, bird or mouse. If at first he prospered, he soon grew thin. He did not understand how man can kill his land. He worked it before dawn, all morning, afternoon, sometimes at dusk. Yet every year his crops grew less, and he knew fear. He plowed from edge of long plowed hill to the plowed rim of neighboring wood and starved the land until at last the land starved him. Virginity. She had for many years known and seen the outer edge of life. She was at least an honest whore, no false Protestant who with wile of roving eye and loose-lipped smile belied her word, her deed. She was more worthy of respect than those who falsely sought and sinned with joy and were not caught. Though Ethel sinned repeatedly, she gained her way at last, repented to a wedding day. She was sincere and honest wife. No furtive sinner lived as happily a life.
This is wonderful.
Of nature's ultimate design. Rainer saw in every buckwheat pod the undisputed mark of God. A simple but a happy man, as free at 1 and 20 as at 63. Rainer knew beyond a doubt what God was all about. "This is God," he said of stone, "only for his breath alone." Red-cheeked Rainer, with his merry eyes, had no patience with doubts or lies. He saw in every bird, seed, every inch of sod, evidence eloquent of God. Sets out upon his own, begins alone, and ends alone. Even a point like Earth in space could be a dark and devious place. And a man might go astray for lack of signs along the way. In search of his own Walden, he could meet many inviting byways, many a primrose street, unless he had a guide to keep from getting lost, Thoreau or A Book of Poems by Robert Frost. Hang on with us. Okay, so thank you so much. Once again, thank you so much for coming. I want to thank my vocalists. Aren't they the best? Yes. And just to let you know, last week, all three of us were in recording sessions. We're making a professional CD of this entire concert. And they will be available soon. So we're having a pre-sale tonight for any of you that would like a CD. You may purchase it, and we will have it to you within
4 to 8 weeks.
Yeah, 4 to 8 weeks. Okay? Does that work for you?
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Once again, thank you so much for coming. Great audience.